I work as a researcher at CETO, and the last 4 years I have been involved in the development of a large-scale diagnostic educational test for three subjects, math, English and Dutch. And in this presentation I will talk about how we developed the adaptivity for this diagnostic test. Of course, I did not do this alone. I was project leader of research and development. Professor Hoyting from the University of Utrecht developed the actual psychometric model. Daniel van der Palm, a colleague of mine at CETO, was responsible for realizing the adaptive design, the analysis needed for that. And then Peter van Os, a colleague, actually programmed the adaptive module, and Johanna Hofstee was the manager responsible for the development of the adaptive module. In this talk, I will first outline very quickly what actually the purpose of this diagnostic educational test was, and why we chose to use adaptivity in this test. Then I will talk about the adaptive design, the principle of the adaptive design and how it was implemented, and then about the adaptive rules used in the design, and I will give a short summary. The diagnostic test had a formative function. The ministry, the Dutch ministry, wanted a midway secondary education, a test that would be really for the teachers, for the students, that provide information to the teachers about the learning needs of students so that they could adjust the learning process to the needs of the students. A really formative function. And for this reason, they asked us to design diagnostic tests. Now, there are many, many different kind of diagnostic tests. So the first thing we had to do was actually decide what kind of diagnostic test would fit with this purpose. You have several levels of diagnosis. So the most simple diagnostic test will actually only show whether there is a problem or not. Does the student master the subject at the required level, yes or no? It's just simply, do you have pain, yes or no? The second level is actually more refined. This is not does it hurt, but where does it hurt? So what is needed? Does the student need to master all the skills and knowledge aspects that are actually necessary to yield this performance? So you get a profile of strengths and weaknesses. And this third level is an explanation, actually, why does it hurt? Well, in this test, we focused at the second level. So we wanted to know what are the strengths and weaknesses. Does the student master all the skills and knowledge aspects that are required? We wanted to give fine-grained information for each of these students, so not only the students at the lower end of the continuum or in the higher end, but for all students. And we decided to base it on student models. A student model, an example of a student model English. This I chose this example basically because it's in English, so it's easier to explain, and also because it's the smallest student model, so it fits nicely on the screen. You have four in for English writing. You have four sub skills: social proficiency, structuring. So the students should be able to write a text that is socially proficient, should be able to structure the text, should be able to use appropriate phrasing, and should be able to use the appropriate grammar and spelling. This is further refined into smaller aspects. So social proficiency, for example, consists of two aspects: using the right tone of voice and using the right conventions. And for each of the subjects, a student model like this has been developed. And for each of the aspects in the student model, we want to be able to diagnose. and we want to know the whether the student is, the probability that the student is below level, at level, or above the required level. So we have, in this case, the smallest one, we have 8 aspects that we want to diagnose and to provide a diagnosis for. So we have many diagnoses. Well, the first estimates of the time needed for the smallest model, even if we have very short items, we would need at least over 3 hours. For a little bit longer, bigger for Dutch, we would need 6 hours, etc. So an impossible length of time. Not only that, we have also different educational routes, so it should also fit with the each of the educational routes. So we used CAT to allow for more test outcomes in a given time, which is a bit different because until now we've seen a lot of examples where the CAT is used to increase the precision in the whole ability distribution, and especially at the extremes. Here, the efficiency is used to generate more test outcomes. So in a given time, we are able to give more diagnosis. For this, we use the new psychometric model developed by Professor Hoytink. This model was also used because we had a very fast implementation, very large scale, many tests, so it had to be really easy in calculation to do it in online. The basic principle is that you have 3 diagnostic hypotheses, and after each answer, we recalibrate what the probability of each hypothesis is. And then at the end of the result, we have for each aspect the probability that the student is below level, the probability that the student is at level, and the probability that the student is above level. So we do not generate a traditional score. We do not use an IRT model. The very simple idea is we have 3 groups of students. The group of students that's below level, the one that is at level, and a group that is above level. We have a new student and we want to know where is he. We have prior probabilities. It's more probable that the student is, for example, in the middle group, at he is master's at level. We give a task and the student answers the task correctly. And then it becomes more probable that the student is either at level or above level. Then we give a task that is excellently discriminates between the at level and above level. Again, the student answers correctly. Again, higher probability. And we continue to give this kind of tasks. Then it was decided what kind of which level of adaptivity we want. We started out and thinking, well, of course, the maximum is always the best. We have linear, we already calculated an insane amount of time, and we go to task level. But there is a lot of area in between. And we decided to use all the levels in between. So we have, first of all, different versions. For each track of education, we have a different version. So in the end, we have 3 subjects times 5 different item banks, different tests for each track. Then we decided to use sections. So in the first stage, we start to measure all the main attributes. And then only in the second stage, we start to go to the sub-attributes, but only if there's still time and there is an indication that is actually necessary, that there is something wrong, something going on. So we have a first stage where we measure all the main attributes and then a referral stage. And then we have blocks of tasks. How does this work? This is a position that you often see. We have seen a lot. So we have a first block of tasks. If the student seems to be at level, he gets a second block. If he seems to be very good, he gets the green block. If he seems not to master it, he gets the lower. and we have a second layer, a third layer, and then we have the stage two layer. So we have blocks of tasks. Why we decided to use blocks and not full adaptivity? First of all, we had existing blocks. We had a lot of new item types that generate usually a lot of responses. For example, this one with a text where the student can has to fill in words in several positions. So basically, we already had blocks of item responses. We had also some blocks of tasks that should be kept together. For example, in Dutch, we have a longer text and several tasks related to this one text. So we already had existing blocks. A second important reason to use blocks is the recalibration. We already saw if we needed to recalibrate. The Dutch ministry decided to go from a national-wide test to a volunteer sample, so we saw our pre-testing sample seriously reduced, and we needed to be able to recalibrate. And with blocks, it's much easier to recalibrate items within an adaptive test. So even when you're running your adaptive test, you can start to recalibrate. Another reason is more from the assessment experts. They want to be able to review and have a non-statistical, non-psychometrical control about the content, about the ordering, and about avoiding certain context effects. And this is important. We really saw that it was important because when we asked the assessment experts to check all the blocks we designed, there were in fact blocks completely imbalanced. Even though the items seemed to be different in terms of metadata, were different templates, different types, but the actual task was identical. It was all the time the students had five times in a row had to decide what was the appropriate address of a letter. So this content balancing was important. We had an unexpected group of tasks asking exactly the same of students. And of course, also task exposure control is easier when you have blocks. And important also, the demanding of the adaptive module is really a lot less with this kind of blocks. So how did it work? We had we had a combination of different levels of adaptivity. So we had the two-stage referral, and within each of these attributes, you had the block design. So we had a huge amount of blocks, and of course, all the assessment experts had to review all these blocks. It was a really tremendous work. At first, we thought to let them go like this, the students, so with each attribute, and then the committee reviewing said it's becoming really boring, so we decided to reverse. And so in the end, the students get first the first block of each attribute, then they go, and behind here they get some seeding items, and then they go to the second layer, and then they go to the third layer, and then they go to the second stage. Of course, this was not realized in one go. We had the first adaptive test, we had a reduced setting with half the items, that was less adaptive. And in the second year, we had all the items there, and we had this whole schedule. So how did we realize this block assembly? There's always the discussion, do you do it by hand or automated? We do it automated. We had the procedure was as follows. Basically, we make sure that they are randomly distributed over the blocks, and the middle one consists of items that are either in this from here and from here. And this we do not once, but 1,000 times. So we do 1,000 times, we do the random distribution. Then it's checked for each of these solutions if it's acceptable. Time-wise, there is a check and an estimation of the time that it will cost for a student to run through these blocks. And if that is allowed, if it doesn't fit the solution is thrown away. If none of the solutions work, then there will be items removed until it fits within the time limit. And the block should not be too different in size. So we want sort of equally sized blocks. Then we start to simulate for each of this 1,000 settings. We simulate 1,000 students that are below level, 1,000 at level, and 1,000 above level, and we calculate what is the accuracy, the diagnostic accuracy. And that looks like this. That is a table. This is very simple. We get much more results. And then basically the best one is selected and presented to the assessment experts. The best 10 are kept. So if the assessment experts say, well, we don't like this because, then we start to check the second best and see if there is the problem resolved. If this is not the case, then there is also the possibility of actually manually adjusting it. So we can remove manually or start to adjust. This is not an easy task and is really a lot of work, so we try to prevent that. So the assessment experts, they have really to be convincing that it's really necessary to do this manual adjustment. There was a slide that I overstepped, because one aspect that is really important are these prior model probabilities. They are calculated, again, using a simulation to see once you have a solution and a fixed diagnostic accuracy, they're going to search for the optimal prior to reach this diagnostic accuracy. Again, using simulations. That optimal prior, the method to develop to find this optimal prior was developed by my colleague Van der Palm. And where's my mouse? Ah, here. The time management, as you see, is part in those blocks. We make sure that I think 95% of the student has enough time to finish the whole test. But of course, the stop has to be done by the school. The school has to say, okay, 3 hours is over, now we stop. This did lead to some problems, I must admit. We have also 3 adaptive rules. Of course, we do not want to keep testing when it's not necessary, but we also do not want to give a diagnosis based on one response. So basically, we say if it's very certain, you can define your own criterion. Say if it's the probability that you belong to a certain category is higher than 0.95, you can skip the rest. You don't have to continue. You can do also an estimated probability. Say we want the skip criterion at the level where 95% of all students is correctly diagnosed, which is slightly different, and usually what we saw is that it leads to a lower probability where you can skip. So it enhances skipping. And anyway, at the end of the phase, you can also you skip automatically to the next level. Then the referral order. We have calibrated the first steps, and then we want to decide which of the sub-attributes we are going to do first. And we decided to build an algorithm that emphasizes problems for the students, for the at-level student and the higher-level students. So we start to look into those aspects where they need remedial teaching. For the lowest-level students, we start to focus that in general are at the lowest level, we start to focus at the aspects that they already master. So there is the reversal of the reasoning. So the focus is where does the student need help? And the usability. When can we actually report a result? When can we report? Now this is again the same script, the skip criterion. So if a student skipped, we are certain enough and we can report. and when you reach the last item of a block, so in of the phase. So if you reach the end of phase one, then we can report, or phase two, and then we can report the sub-attributes. So how is this implemented? We have an adaptive test that contains of the items. We have an adaptive model. In the model is this is a psychometric core that actually calculates the test outcome, the probabilities that we are going to report, and where is also automatically determined if we know enough to generate a report for each of the aspects. So at the beginning, all the aspects cannot, all the diagnoses cannot be reported, and during the test, they will flip to reporting in the adaptive model. In the driver itself, we have the task parameters, and actually in the driver itself is very easy, almost text-like information. We have the task parameters, we have the block design, we have the settings for seeding, because we are also seeding, we have to maintain our test, so we are actually seeding. And the skip or stop criterion that you chose is a choice, and the prior model probabilities. And basically it's all text. This is a tool which we use to test our driver if everything is going okay. Here we have the actual driver. Here you can choose a setting for students. You can also choose if you just want one go. We choose a very bad student and a very good student, and we see that whether all the blocks are actually touched, nothing is going wrong. This is here we can see whether the report status is reached, and here you see how the student actually is going, the fake student, the simulated student is going through the test. And this can be repeated really fast so that we can detect whether there is a problem somewhere in the driver. Because, of course, you cannot manually go through all the possible paths that the student can walk through. For example, this one. Here is someone who answered everything incorrect, and he is going more to the left. This is the first block, and again, to the left side. Because he is not good, he gets the most left side. And this is, we see, a good student, and he will get more the blocks for the good student. There is one thing that I should mention. These blocks are not constructed on the basis of difficulty. It is not that these are easy blocks and these are difficult blocks. It's based on the difference in probabilities, so a discrimination. So here we have items that make a good distinction between students that are below and an at level. And here we have items that are make an excellent distinction between students at level and above level. So this is really different. So sometimes assessment experts complain that it seemed very difficult. So it's difficult. How is it possible? Because that is not the selection rule. So maybe in the future we need to adapt to add a rule to prevent that we get a very difficult test for low-level students. Even though it's perfect for diagnosing, is for students not so pleasant. So I have to stop for the discussion. So what we did, we have used a new psychometric model. We combined various levels of adaptivity to yield as many diagnoses as possible and give as much needed information to the teacher as possible. We have an automated block assembly, but a possibility of manually adjusting and review. And we implemented three adaptive rules and seeding to maintain the test. A lot of research still needs to be done because this is basically our first go, our first prototype. We have managed to do this year. We want to compare the new psychometric model to existing models, like IRT models. What are the advantages, disadvantages to be able to make a well-defined choice. We want to know how we can decide the number of layers we need in our design. We took three, maybe we need four, maybe we need only two. How big the block sizes have to be, how many responses need to be in each of the blocks, And we get also the request for teacher referral, that not the program, there's no algorithm deciding which further testing we do, but that the teacher decides this. Block assembly, again, a lot of research needed. How we decide this priors, we saw that the priors work very well for the main attributes, but for the smaller attributes, it works less fine, especially if the they work in opposite directions. It's not always perfect. There's also the idea, maybe we, instead of using simulations, we try to find the best design, the optimal design. And also, because the testing time really remains a problem in reality, could we define a way to define the minimum number of item responses needed to be put into the design, for example, for 2 hours? And is it still at an acceptable level, our accuracy? Oh, sorry, I'm... The adaptive rules, especially the algorithm for referral, we can think of other algorithms, and we have some first steps for other algorithms. And basically, it's also possible in the adaptive driver, in the adaptive module, to implement other algorithms for this referral. And for seeding, we still have to develop an algorithm for determining what is the best item to replace, which is still also further research. Thank you. Any questions? Then I thank you. I suppose this is stop.